for me. My whole world, you make something out of nothing. You change my whole life.
All right,
you
now.
Change my whole world. You make something out of nothing. Oh, that's so beautiful.
Yeah,
so beautiful. Isn't that a beautiful thing?
Yes.
When Jesus.
Jesus
can take something
make out of nothing.
Out of nothing.
Yes.
And that's what he did. He said, poof, let there be light.
Yeah.
Ain't that something?
Yeah.
He said, hallelujah. He spoke a word and said, let there be Cheryl.
Yep.
He said, let there be Lisa. Let there be Willie. Hallelujah. He said, let there be the gospel party.
Hallelujah.
I believe that God took nothing and he made something out of it. He said, let there be a friendship that's going to unite between these three, these four, Kyle. You know, he said, I'm going to make something out of you guys.
Yes.
And put y'all together.
Hallelujah.
Like you never. Because the thing is, Lisa, I'm not from Buffalo even. You know,
wow.
I'm from Detroit, and, you know, when my husband met me, you know, our relationship, you know, it was beautiful. It is beautiful, you know, and it just continues to blossom and to continue to grow, because friendship is the primary thing of any relationship. And you know what? No real marriage can even sustain itself if there isn't a basis of friendship that's going to be
friendship.
There.
Yeah.
I mean, your true basis has to be God. But then on top of that, God has to be that love and that friendship, you know, that no matter what happens, I'm going to be there for you.
Because marriage is based on friendship, of course, love,
mm-hmm,
and like
mm-hmm.
you said, God being in it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not marriage, a long marriage is not something that's always good all the time.
Mm-hmm.
It's
mm-hmm.
going through
bumps, bruises, ups and downs,
valleys,
hills and valleys.
Absolutely.
And being able to work through
those things, right? You know, and however your marriage ends up, you know, let's end it on a positive note at all times. You know, I know that, you know, we're not here as spiritual counselors. You know, we don't condone divorce or anything like that. You know, if you got a divorce, then so be it. You know, don't relish, you know, in that, you know, a guilt. You know, it is what it is. Pick yourself up and say to that person, you know what? Even if we didn't make it in this relationship, even if we maybe shouldn't have got divorced, but let's still remain friends. Ooh, that's deep, ain't it?
Yeah, but...
But you don't have to be in close proximity with that person to remain friendly.
Because the reason that's hard, because usually when it ends, separate or divorce,
mm-hmm.
this friendship has
There's
been
There's a lot
severed,
of bitterness.
Severed.
Right, because something had to have happened for it to come to an end. But I just would hate to see people get a divorce and go to hell.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Time
is a great deciding factor, because the way you feel, we always deal with things in our emotions.
Right.
So it takes a minute for time to work that thing out
mm-hmm.
before we can say, you know, you can see that person and say, hey, how you doing? And have no ill feelings.
Right.
So time is always a deciding factor when something ends. They go their separate way, you go your separate way. For whatever reason, it didn't work out, but that doesn't mean you have to go to your grave hating one another.
That's
you know
correct.
What? And I was talking about that as well earlier. We were talking about that from a friendship standpoint as well. You know, even if it's not a marriage that we're talking about, just a pure platonic friendship, those relationships, even in themselves, have to deal with conflict. And even though you didn't go to a judge and say, judge, friendship me with this person. You know what I'm saying? There's no license.
Right.
You have a marriage license, but you don't have friendship licenses. You know, you don't go to friendship divorce court. But even if you separate, you know, with a friend, you still have that emotional attachment that you have to deal with. Because when you break up a friendship, you're looking at that person rolling your ass.
Hold up, Cheryl. You said don't go to a friendship divorce court.
Right. You don't go there.
Don't when we see divorce court show, a lot of those start out as friends.
You know they do. They start out, but they be bar friends a lot of times.
And even a lot of those court shows, the people start out as, a lot of them, as friends. And then somebody does something that somebody didn't like.
My marriage didn't start out as friends, though. We was friends for like a day.
your marriage? Really? Wow.
Kyle and I have been, it was, you know what? Our relationship started at everything started the same day. The friendship and the relationship. So it was it was a lot of, you know, it was a lot of fun at all times. But that's but the thing is that's my husband's real personality though. You know, he's a loving person at all times. Now Kyle was the type of person, he want to be friends with everybody. I want to be friends with one person at a time and get to know you up close and personal. You know, let me analyze
so
this
he,
thing.
So he might have that networking spirit.
He's got a huge networking spirit. He's the type of person that, and I hate to say this, but you know that scripture where it says that when he comes back like a thief in the night, it's going to be two in the field and one is going to wake up and, you know, and be gone. And there's going to be two lying in the bed and one would be gone. I often have to pray to God all the time to get my soul together because my husband is such a outgoing, friendly, loving person that I'm like, dang. I'm the minister in the house. he doesn't even carry. You see where I'm going with this?
Yeah, I see where you're going. Yeah.
He doesn't carry a title per se. I'm holding this title, and so therefore, there are these standards that I ought to be uplifted and that I ought to be upholding. So I'm working hard at it.
Dapper Don is like more friendly.
He's very friendly.
Well, you're very friendly. So let me just say,
I'm a nice person, but he's very friendly.
Right, where he will actually get in. With the people.
He means it in his heart where I can communicate with
you. Right, you can communicate.
And it's a difference between, and that's what God had to pierce my heart about.
You kind of have a wall, too.
I have a shield, a wall, a shield. I got sticks, bricks.
No. She's very friendly. Cheryl comes off sweet and friendly, but as you get the learner, you learn that is like this little shield. She will only let you get so close. Where Dapper Don is, he's in there with you.
He is.
He's
right
in there.
Right from day one.
I'm very friendly.
Yeah, you seem like that type of person as well, but
My goodness.
Yeah. You know, like,
I
heard you say that, you know what, I look forward to getting to know people. And when you said that, I was like, wow, that's a quality that I admire about you so much. I think that not only are you a beautiful person, you know, exteriorly, and not only are you an intelligent person, but you have that glow about you, your emotional side. You know, you are such a friendly person that, you know, I aspire to be more like you.
We want to be more like you, Lisa.
And I'm going to work on it. You know, I don't necessarily believe in New Year's resolutions for myself on a personal level, but I don't despise resolutions because I think that for some people, it becomes the beginning that they need. So for the new year, I think it's a good thing to, you know, it's never anything wrong with planning. You know, you need to have a plan because without a plan, you're going to, you know, you'll just be a glob out there and you're going to fail. So you should have some type of plan, whether it's I'm going to do better with my budget, better working on my friendship, a better relationship with God, because this might be the year that you get it right before you get taken out.
You know what, Cheryl, I got so many things that I need to change. I don't even know where to start now.
So, Lisa, what would be your advice on where do we start when it comes to things that we need to change in our lives? I know the new year is coming, but not necessarily relating it to the new year. How do we start with all these many changes?
You know, and it's funny because as the new, we have 3 days left, and I like to spend the last of the year just reflecting in downtime. And just also reflecting on the things that have occurred through the year, changes that I've been through, friendships, whatever changes that I've gone through, whether it's financially, physical, mental, social, relocating, whatever it is, you just kind of, I like to journal. So I like to journal throughout the year, and then at the end of the year, go back and read the whole journal and just kind of sum it up in my own thing. So, and I think I mentioned this last week, that I don't believe that God is saying anything new. There's no new cliches about what's to come, you know, whatever for next year. I believe that he's just saying, finish what I gave you to do the other year or last year, the 2 years ago. That was new when I gave it to you. Finish those things. If he began that thing, he wants to complete it in us. And I believe that's what we have. I have a whole lot of unfinished business. There's things that are on the table that are not finished. So I want to go back and do that. So going into the new year with the new changes, I don't think it's anything big and scary. Going into it with an open heart, with an open mind, ready to receive whatever that new thing that God wants to do or that assistance, being open to the assistance that he would send or the people that's going to help us in this next season.
Mm-hmm.
I'm always praying for personal, and I'm sure you guys have probably prayed this before,
mm-hmm.
Personal investors.
Right.
If you're like me, you have any projects that you have a lot of ideas, but you don't have the funding to get them off the ground.
Absolutely.
So I pray that God would send those investors. This is why I'm so open to being friendly and meeting people, because you never know which one of those people may be disguised as a billionaire or a millionaire who has the money, who just wants to pour into somebody that's doing something for the kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
So I'm praying for that.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely beautiful. And you know what I would say? I would pray that if people are looking to make resolutions, and this is for you too, because you said you have a lot of things that you're looking forward to doing or a lot of unfinished business. My personal take on it is take on just as much as what you can chew. Don't choke yourself trying to change too many things.
I thought of two things.
So what would be the two for
you?
Well,
one I can't tell you.
Okay.
It's very personal.
Okay, that's a good thing if you have personal stuff. Work on personal business.
Number one thing.
Okay.
And then the other one is procrastination. I think I have procrastinated a lot this year.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to work on just go and do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, of course, plan it, write it down, plan
right.
it.
Right.
But do it. Just don't spend time. Because I spend too much time speculating, you know, thinking about
it. Right. Well, what about the reverse of this whole resolutions? What about the opposite? As opposed to planning what you're going to do, how about for the new year, be real? If you ain't going to do nothing, just say, I ain't doing nothing.
Hello? And I can always respect that. I can respect that. Don't say I have to make out a new year's resolution.
Mm-hmm.
Just finish your to-do list.
Finish what's on your list already. Or you know what? I have to be honest. If you need a minute, if you need to say, you know what? I have been so overloaded for the past X amount of years that I just can't go any further. You know, I think that we can burden ourselves down when we begin to try to say, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. Give it up to God. I say for New Year's, let's lay it on the altar and let God deal with it and for us to just handle God's business.
So all right. So what you're saying, Cheryl, is...
Lay it on
what
the
I
altar.
Should,
put it
what
on
I
the
should
altar.
Do is not even make any of those plans. Just go to God, put it, just go take some time. Like Lisa was saying, reflecting, but in my case, go to the altar, pray, spend some time, maybe a day.
Right.
A half a day.
Yeah.
Maybe a whole year. You know, the Bible says that these things, a whole year. The Bible says that these things come by fasting and praying. He didn't say nothing about, I need you to do A, B, and C to fix your life. He said, give it to me. Lay it on the altar. And then he will give you the desires of your heart. All God wants us to do is praise him and worship him. The Bible says, man don't work, man don't eat. He ought not eat, rather. So, yes, you have to get up and do the day-to-day things. You know, you got to take care of your body and, you know, your daily hygiene. You know, take care of your family and your children. But even though you are going through the routine of the day, he said, I came that you may have life and have that life more abundantly. It's too much. It's too many problems that are already going in. Man born of a woman has but a few days, and those few days are full of trouble. So why are you piling the trouble on? Matter of fact, I say for New Year's, let's stop making resolutions. Let's just give it up to God.
Wow.
I'm done. That's it.
All right. So Cheryl said, just give it up to God. Just stop. Don't make the resolution.
Stop worrying about it.
And Lisa said, finish
unfinished business.
Unfinished business.
Just, I think that's beautiful.
Just,
so people have something to pull from the pot. So some people are going to finish
So y'all kind of made it easy for me. Y'all made it kind of easy because basically now it's like a no-stress situation. Just go to God, put it on the altar. And
that's
just chill out, let him work it, but do those basic...
You got to do what he tell you.
Those basic applications that we need to do.
Because let's not forget, the Bible says that a man that doesn't take care of his family is worse than an
infidel.
Right. So you got to go through the routine.
Right.
But what I tell people all the time is even though the scripture says man don't work, he ought not eat. Because we say don't eat, though. It says ought not eat. But I need for people to understand something. Just because you go to work every day does not mean that that is your livelihood. You're just following, being obedient to the scripture. You need to go to work. You need to go to work. But I say at all times, just because I get paid on Friday doesn't mean that that's the way my bills are going to get paid. My trust and my faith is in God. Even though I get up and go to work every single day, like Lisa said, it might be a billionaire somewhere in 2014 waiting to pay all my bills. But